good? He said, how are you? And welcome to worship on this third Sunday after the day of Epiphany. And we want to say thank you to our worship band for kicking us off with a beautiful piece that especially speaks well of Epiphany and the season of light and God's revelation. The ending, the last Sunday in Epiphany, is known as the Transfiguration. And that's where Jesus ascends on the mountain and he sees this incredible glowing, where he glows literally in dazzling white. I was thought of that story this morning as I was driving over to here to Hayfield in the fog. Had it not been for the blinking yellow light at the Hayfield intersection, I would have passed right by because the entire town was bathed in fog. So it made me think of the Transfiguration story and the disciples being with Jesus on the mountaintop in that cloud, and what an incredible experience it was. So anyway, on that note, welcome to worship, not only to those of you who are here joining us in our sanctuary, but also to those who are joining us on our live stream. We are delighted that we are able to gather each week as God's people, the church, to be transformed by his life-giving word, to have the opportunity to sing, to share music, to pray for one another, and to experience God's loving presence where we are gathered. And so we are delighted to kick off a brand new week here with a time for worship. Today we have a very busy day. 10 o'clock is Sunday school following worship. Our adult forum will meet downstairs in the youth room this morning. So adult forum in the youth room. And then after church, the youth are going to be going sledding. There's just a couple of them, so they're actually going to leave after church, not this afternoon. But we wish them well. It should be a wonderful day for them to go sledding after the snow that we received this past week. Heads up, also next Sunday, January 29th, is our annual meeting. We encourage you to attend. We want to make sure that we hit our quorum. We have a couple of things to vote on. The first is the proposed 2023 budget. And the second is the call committee's recommendation to call me as your settled pastor. And so that will take place next Sunday, January 29th, in the sanctuary following our worship service. And one other additional calendar item, and that is on Wednesday night, the choir will have choir practice at 6 p.m. And then finally, a sad word to share with you. I want to announce the death of Cindy Tyndale. Funeral arrangements are pending and will be made later today. Our prayers are with Chuck and his family as they mourn Cindy's death. And so we lift up their family in our thoughts and in our prayers on this day. The rest of the announcements I trust for you to read as you have time. And I invite you now to please stand and together let us sing our gathering hymn, Here for You.
Let our praise be a welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your breath come from heaven. Let our hearts with your life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Your fire fall down. Let our shout be your anthem. Your renown fill the skies. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. Let what's dead come to life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. You, our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. We are here for you. Welcome you with praise, Almighty God of love. Be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise, Almighty God of love. Be welcomed in this place. Let every heart adore. Let every soul awake. Almighty God of love. Be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise, Almighty God of love. Be welcomed in this place.
We continue our worship with a word of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who makes all things new and whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, the source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us that we may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. You may be seated as together we sing the song of mercy, Peace in Christ. Mercy. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to please stand as you are able and let us sing our song of praise, Mighty to Save.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the everything I believe in. Now I surrender, I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. Loving God, your loving kindness always goes before us and follows after us. Summon us into your light and direct our steps in the way of goodness that comes through the cross of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 9. There will be no gloom for those who are in anguish. In the former time, the Lord brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. We shall read the Psalm 27 responsively. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? For in the day of trouble, God will give me shelter. Hide me in the hidden places of the sanctuary, and raise me high upon a rock. Hear my voice, O Lord, when I call. Have mercy on me and answer me. Hide not your face from me. Turn not away from your servant in anger. Cast me not away. You have been my helper. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Thus ends the reading.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Mapuana. At this time, I'd like to invite the children forward for our children's sermon. Good morning. How are you guys doing today? That's good. I have today a box. Would any of you guys like to know what's inside the box? Any guesses? Kind of hard to guess, huh? Okay, there's two things in the box, so let's open it and see. And both things have to do with our gospel reading for today. The first thing is this. Does anybody know what this is? A net. And what do you think you use a net like this for? Fishing. How many of you guys have ever gone fishing before? Have you? How many of you guys have caught fish before? A bluegill, huh? That's really good. Good job. Are you looking forward to going fishing this summer? Yeah, me too. How many of you, when you went fishing, did you use a net or a pole?
I used a fishing thing.
Okay, cool. Hey, as long as it works, as long as it catches fish. Well, back in Jesus's day, they did not use poles because how many fish can you usually catch when you use a pole?
A lot.
You can if you're fishing a lot. But how many at a time? You can usually only catch one fish at a time, right? Right? Well, one of the reasons why they used nets back then is if you got in a very good area where there's lots of fish and you put a net down, when you pulled the net back up, how many fish could you catch at a time? Using a bigger net than this one. Quite a few. Yeah, if they were having a really good day out on the boats, they would have a net full of fish. And that was how they made their living, and that was how they fed their families back then. So that was pretty important. Now, I also said that we have something else in the box. You're going to get a kick out of this. Actually, there were some children yesterday at the funeral here at Trinity, and one of them made this, and it got left behind. And I thought, what a beautiful prop for a sermon today. So here's the second item. One of our children yesterday, usually if you take your nets out, how do you get out to where the good fishing spots are? A boat. And look at this amazing paper boat that somebody made. Didn't they do a great job? I know. I wish I knew how to do that. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Well, the reason I brought these props with me this morning is in today's gospel lesson, Jesus comes up to a couple of pairs of brothers, and they are out by the lake, and they are fishing with their dads. And Jesus is so excited. He says to them, come and follow me. And immediately, all four of those brothers got up and they left their boats and their dad and they went to follow Jesus. But the cool thing is, Jesus knew that they were pretty good fisher people. And so he told them, you're not going to leave all that fishing behind. Instead, you're going to fish for people. Now, can you imagine having to fish for people? That doesn't make much sense, does it? But what Jesus was talking about is changing priorities. They would still fish. They would still have time when they came home to visit and be with their fathers and help with the fishing. But in the meantime, God would help them fish for people. And we fish for people every time we invite them to come to church. We fish for people every time we say a prayer before bedtime for someone that we love or care about. Every time we say a prayer before we eat and give thanks to God for that meal. We fish for people every time we learn our Bible stories. Every time we collect money for people who are in need or who need food on their tables. Those are all different examples of how Jesus calls us to follow him, to put down our nets and to follow him and to fish for people. So you guys, as disciples, just like all of us here in the church, are called to be fisher people. So this week, I want you to think about, oh, that's such a cool job, isn't it? That's a cool job. And so we pray for God's help to help us learn how best to fish for people each and every day. There will be moments and opportunities that we have to fish. And that will be, again, through prayer, through inviting people to come, through reading and learning our Bible lessons, and providing help for people. It could be in our families or it could be neighbors who are in need of our help. So let's close with prayer and let's ask God to help us be good fisher people this week, okay? Gracious God, we give you thanks that you give us an important task. You call us to put down our nets, and you call us to change priority, to still fish, but to invest in people. Help us this week to be good fisher people and to look for those opportunities to help, to pray, to learn, and to grow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you guys for coming forward. That was great. We'll put that back in the box. Can you put the net back in the box for me? Great job. Thank you. Very good. Thank you for helping. Thank you. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Now when Jesus heard that John the Baptist had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately, they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately, they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. Here ends the gospel. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Today's gospel lesson is all about happy topics. Fishing, something we here in Minnesota know a whole lot about since we live in the land of more than 10,000 lakes. And it's soon approaching that time of year that we all deeply long for, especially after a long winter like this one. We look forward to breaking out our tackle boxes and fishing gear, for shopping for bait, and for finally beginning to air out the cabin. We look forward to that first trip out in the boat, with the sunshine warming our faces and the breeze gently stirring the waters around us. Have you ever wondered why Jesus, when he began his public ministry, began it here by the sea? Ever wonder why the first people he called to follow were a bunch of fishermen? Today's gospel further reveals who this Jesus is by the people that he chooses and the place where he chooses to begin. A couple of weeks ago in his baptism, we learned from the voice from heaven who named him as a son of God. Today's lesson, we are learning the shape of his ministry and what kind of Messiah he is truly going to become, and is definitely one that will be different and unexpected. For instance, at the beginning of today's gospel reading, when Jesus learns of John the Baptist's arrest, he changes gears. This foreshadows his own arrest later on. And today we get the first hint that the long-awaited Messiah will not be immune from suffering, and yes, maybe even death. But we also see in those early first verses that Jesus leaves his hometown of Nazareth behind, and he makes Capernaum his new home base. Not everyone can do that. Leave what is familiar behind them and begin anew someplace else. But Jesus does it because the kingdom of heaven calls us forward, out of our comfort zones, in order that we might experience a much bigger, more fuller life than we could have ever imagined. And yes, that means being open to change. But we also need to ask ourselves, why Capernaum? One would assume that the king, the Messiah, would base himself near the capital, near the palace in Jerusalem, the holy city. But no, Jesus comes to Capernaum, a little town by the sea of only about 1,000 people. And here he begins his public ministry, not among the elite of Herod's court, but among ordinary people, people who like to fish, who work long, hard hours every single day. People in that day and age who were near the bottom of the social ladder. In fact, fishermen were some of the ones who suffered the most under Roman rule, because most of their catch went to pay off hefty Roman taxes, sometimes 40 or 50% of everything they caught. When Jesus bases his ministry here, we see God actively standing beside those who are least and those who are suffering the most from the domination of Rome. We also learn that Jesus' public ministry begins in the midst of family ties. In today's lesson, he calls a pair of brothers, Simon and Andrew, and then later a second pair of brothers, James and John. Not only are they brothers, but they are also sons, with Zebedee, the father of James and John, mentioned three different times in today's lesson. That means that Jesus' ministry begins in the midst of our daily lives, in the midst of family relationships, which are so much a part of our world. And yet, something new is about to happen. Jesus calls them even when it will disrupt those family bonds. Zebedee could not have been very thrilled when his sons left him in the boat and they walked away. Sons back then were supposed to care for their fathers, and they were supposed to learn from them and carry on the family business. Jesus seems to disrupt all of that. Or does he? The truth is, when we follow Jesus, they will still be sons, but they will be sons in a very different way. They will now be sons who are obedient to God's will. And just because they left does not mean that they are not still able to care for their father. Capernaum is near enough to where they are going in their ministry that it is very likely that they would go for a few days with Jesus and still be able to return to Capernaum. And perhaps, too, by their leaving for a few days at a time, others, too, could step forward and become a bigger network of care instead of only the responsibility falling on the two sons. And so the point is, Jesus doesn't take away our family ties. Instead, he reprioritizes them and enlarges our life so that we can be more fully who God has called us to be. He helps us to be more fully the sons and daughters that God has asked us to be. And one more observation. Perhaps Jesus called a pair of brothers because he knew that the way of discipleship would be difficult. And by calling brothers, that way they would have extra support. They would never be sent out alone. But with brothers having their back, they knew they would have that encouragement. And so finally we come to their job, fishing. So often when we think about ourselves, we often believe that we are what we do. And notice here that Jesus does not take them away from fishing, but instead he changes what they will be fishing for. In other words, he changes their purpose and he changes their priority. No longer are they solely fishing to pay off Rome or simply to earn a paycheck. No, now they are fishing for God, and they are fishing for people. They are now working and investing in people in God's kingdom instead of material things. And this is what Jesus does for each of us. He calls us and he enlarges our lives, and he gives us purpose and priority. We don't work for ourselves. We don't work solely to earn a paycheck. Instead, God calls us to follow as we work for God and for each other and for the healing of the world. There can be no greater task than this. I'm also always amazed how when Jesus called them, they immediately left the boat and their father and followed him. Immediately. No hesitation. No taking a few minutes to weigh the pros and cons before coming to a decision. And it makes me wonder, what did they see in this Jesus that enabled them to react in such a way? Perhaps they saw the Messiah, the face of God calling them to a far fuller life than they ever before imagined. So much so that they could do nothing else except leave, because they truly desired to come and follow. But I also wonder what Jesus saw in them when he called them by name. Did he see two sets of brothers worn down by fishing for Rome? Did he see two sets of brothers tired of mending nets and cleaning fish? Or did he see beyond their fears and their failures? Did he truly see the heart of them as only God can? A beloved brother and a beloved son of God who was in need of a new life that only God can give. Tomorrow morning when you get up, whether you go to work or to school or even to be with family, remember this new life work that God is calling you to. May we see God just as he sees us, as beloved, as active, as lights shining in the darkness. May we and may others be drawn to follow that light. Thanks be to God. Amen. At this time, we will sing together our song of the day, How Great is Our God.
All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And oh, see how great, how great. Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see. Name above all names.
I invite you to please stand. And together, let us share the faith that we hold in common by reciting together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Today, as we are called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, for the world, and for all who are in need. Almighty God, make your church one in purpose, proclaiming the message of the cross. Help us to work together across differences. Help energize our ecumenical partnerships. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we rejoice at the bounty of your creation. The land and sea harvest in the southern hemisphere and fallow fields in the north. Equip farmers to till and keep the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Savior, in Christ, your reign comes near, and you call all to repentance. Break the rod of the oppressor in every nation. Dispel the shadow of death in places of war and persecution. Grant us leaders who lift up the yokes that burden those who are in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Savior, be a stronghold for those who are in trouble, and be a rock for all who are frightened. Rouse communities to care for neighbors who are in need of shelter, who are facing maltreatment, or who are isolated or alone. We also pray today for your healing. We lift up and ask for your healing for Russ, Tom, Dylan and Kayla, Steve, Denise, Herb, and Gary. We also pray for the Tyndall, Scharberg, Herrick, and Espy families as they mourn the recent loss of their loved ones. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, sustain the ministries of this congregation and all churches in this community. Nurture each congregation's unique witness to your presence. Foster mutual respect and inspire our cooperation in loving our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we praise you for the faithful who have gone ahead of us, both famous and unknown. Help us to leave our nets and follow, and bring us with them to the fullness of your promise of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, O God, we bring to you our needs and our hopes, trusting always in your wisdom and power, revealed in Christ crucified, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, we will continue our service with the offering of our gifts and our tithes. And I will go get the hunger pot for those who have noisy offering to share.
To be when the time is finally right, will you open up my eyes, show me everything you want me to see? This life is not my own. To God alone be the glory, to God alone be the praise. everything I say and do, let it be all for you. The glory is yours alone, yours alone. Take the offering I bring, you are more than what I sing. Can I give you every part of me? Turn these pennies into gold, take this life I call my own, until I am running after your heart. I'm needing to let go, to God alone be the glory, to God alone be the praise. Everything I say and do, let it be all for you. The glory is yours alone. We will rise and we will fall. Would you remain after all? You're glorious and beautiful. You're beautiful. To God alone be the glory, to God alone be the praise. Everything I say and do, let it be all for you. The glory is yours alone, the glory is yours alone, yours alone.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please stand as we receive the benediction and blessings of Almighty God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us together sing our ascending song.
As you go on your way, may Christ go with you. May you go before you to show you the way. May he go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over, within you to give you peace. As you go on your way, may Christ go with you. May you go before you to show you the way. May he go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over,